Hello, good morning to you all. Today we discuss cryptography and digital signature, some nice applications of node theory. And I am Dr. G. Suresh Kumar, NSS Kendra College, Chennai. The objectives of today's lecture is to introduce you to the idea of public key encryption, introduce to the design of public key encryption system, RSA algorithm and applications of number theory, RSA techniques like key setup and encryption and decryption processes, demo of RSA technique by an example, and introduce you to the idea of digital signature and digital signature systems design. Okay. Now the history of asymmetric encryption because of this one. A symmetric or traditional communication system is it requires two equal parties so that there is only one key. Key means encryption technique that should be known to both the parties and used for encryption as well as for decryption. Generally, it involves substitution or permutation of the alphabets of the message. And the main true drawbacks of the symmetric key algorithms are the sender needs a secure method of telling the key to the receiver who may be in a remote place. A separate key is needed for each one we may communicate it to. But the public key encryption uses only two keys, we will see now. That is the motivation for this public key encryption system. Instead of mere permutation or substitution, it uses some design nice applications of number theory concepts like congruences, prime powers, modular images, prime factorization, etc. It uses two keys, one is a public key, other is a private key. The public key is known to all and used to encrypt the messages to that person. Private key is known only to the receiver and is used to decrypt the messages encrypted by the maximum public key. The notion of username and password is a famous and the most widely used example of the asymmetric encryption today. Username is the public key which is known to all, like our email IDs, and the password is known only to ourselves because it is a private key. This is a public key encryption system. Let the M be the message to be sent. Usually it will be a string of integers. If it is a text, we can convert the alphabets of the characters or the letters by their ASCII codes and you get into a string of integers. And now first process is encryption, that is the M is changed to a ciphertext C by the formula C congruent to encryption of M. It is this ciphertext that we are sending to the receiver. The receiver get back to the original message M by the decryption process and using formula M equal to decryption using secret key of C. So public key is used for encryption while secret key is used for decryption. Public key is a published one and the private key is a secret one. System is like this one. We have a message, we use the private key, public key. The process is encryption and we will get a ciphertext. And the ciphertext is at the receiver's end. He uses his private key and the process is decryption and the key gets back to the message. Now, the security aspects of this asymmetric encryption. Asymmetric encryption. Although, like the usual asymmetric systems, where various permutations can be tried, a brute force such attack is always theoretically possible here also, but the keys we will use here will be normally too large, more than 512 bits or 1024 bits normally, so that a brute force such attack is practically impossible because it may take several years to produce the output. That is the security of this one. So generally we use very large numbers to enhance the security, although it may make the system somewhat slower than the symmetric systems. But it is made too hard to solve the problem of computing the private key from the public key in practice and real time. So that a brute force attack may take several years to solve. That is the security of this asymmetric encryption or public key encryption. Now come to the RSA algorithm. This algorithm was invented by the three persons, Rivers, Schramm and Adelman of MIT in 1977. That's why the name came RSA. And the every user has to generate a public key and a private key as follows. First one is select a large number at random, that is called system modulus, n is called system modulus. Then find the Euler quotient function value of phi n. We can note that if p is prime, then phi of p is p minus 1. If n is factorized into p1 b to the pr, then phi of n is phi of p1 into phi of p to the phi of pr, which is same as p1 minus 1 into p2 minus 1 into the pr minus 1. Compute with phi n. And then compute the encryption exponent e, such that b is a number lying between 1 and phi n, and bcd of phi and e is phi n and e is 1, that is phi is relatively prime to phi n. So any number relatively prime to phi n and lying between these two numbers 1 and phi n can be chosen, that's e. And once we have the pair en is the public key, we can publish that one. Then for decryption process, we have to find the decryption exponent d by the formula ed congruent to 1 modulo phi n. E is known. So we can find d from this equation, congruence equation. Once we got e, once we got d, then the pair dn will be the private key. And keep it as a secret, just like passwords. That was the key setup process. Now the encryption and decryption process. The original message is converted to a string of integers. M usually uses the ASCII codes of its letters or characters. And M must be smaller than the system modulus N. If it is larger, then we can split into several blocks of integers and each of them can be processed one by one. Encryption process is this one. To encrypt the M, sender obtains the public key of the receiver. That is the pair EN, two numbers E and N, N is system modulus, E is the encryption exponent. Now the ciphertext is computed by this formula, M raised to E modulo N, M is an integer. M raised to E modulo N, compute it, we will get an integer, that is the ciphertext. It is the ciphertext that is sent to the receiver, and receiver get back to M by this formula. Using the secret private key, the receiver uses a private key, that is a pair D and N, N is system modulus and D is the decryption exponent. Then M can be required back from C by the formula C raised to D modulo N, it will be M, and that is the RSA process. Now come to an example. Choose N is 187, let M be one, just one example, that is system modulus. This is not a prime number, so a factorized into prime numbers 17 and 11. So that phi of n is 16 into 10, that is 160. Now find the encryption exponent e such that e less than 160 and GCD of e and 160 is 1. We can choose 7. Yes, so many numbers may be there, I choose 7. 7 is less than 160 and unlikely prime to 160. So my public key is the pair 7187. Now we have to find the decryption exponent. Consider the formula ED congruent to 1 modulo 160. Here E is 7, so 7D congruent to 1 minus congruent to 1 modulo 160. So 7D minus 1 is a multiple of 160. And D should be less than 160. So choose any such number. I chose 23 as the value of D because 23 into 7 is 161. 161 minus 1 is a multiple of 160. So we have the private key, the pair 23187. Keep the secret. So key setup is over. Public key is here, private key is there. Now take a message and try to ciphertext, make encode it and decode it. So I have chosen message as 88. 88 is less than 187. So that is admissible. Now use the public key to encrypt it. So the public key is the pair 7187. So 7 is the encryption exponent. So 88 raised to 7 modulo 187. If you compute it, it will be 11. And that is the ciphertext C. So C is 11. 11 is going to be sent as 88, and the receiver will get 88 back from 11 by using the private key. The private key is 23187, so private decryption exponent is 23, and 11 raised to 23 modulo 187, if we compute it will be 88, and that is our given message, and that is the decryption process. Okay. If a message has too many alphabets, m will be a string of integers. If there are so many digits, we can split into some blocks of integers, and each of them can be separated one by one. Process one by one. Now the digital signature. The idea is, digital signature is a process of sending a message called one signature, which will be usually associated with some documents to be authorized by him, and which is verifiable by anybody as it belongs to him or not. That is the idea of digital signature. It's actually a message to be sent along to some documents for authorization. This is the design of a pseudo signature. This process also needs two keys similar to cryptography. One is a public key, other is a private key. Your the sender sends the message by his private key, and anyone can verify it by his public key. So public key are to be published in a directory of national agency called key distribution agency. Anyone can, only the signer who has the private key can generate a valid signature, but anyone can verify it because the public key is published. That is the idea of a digital signature. Now we see that we first use the private key to sign and the public key to verify it. So it is the reverse process of the cryptography. Cryptography is the opposite way. Using the public key, we are encoding it, encrypt it, and using the private key, the receiver decode it. So they are reverse processes. Now this is a system design, okay, digital signature. A famous and widely known digital signature is our mobile number itself. I can make a call from my registered mobile number, RMN. Anyone can verify it since my mobile number is published. If we register our mobile number with some bank or etc., we have to do our transaction from that number only. So RMN is nowadays a very common technical term. There is a digital signature act actually. Now it is used for digital signature in banking, net banking, also for DTS services, ration cards, and so many government purposes. Now government is in a process of making Aadhaar as our digital signature for all purposes. This is a system digital signature. We have a message that should be signed. So we use our private key and we'll sign it and we'll get a fixed length signature. And because this signature is to be verified by the receiver, and so receiver gets our public key and we'll verify it and we'll get the conclusion whether it is valid or invalid. That's the idea. And thank you one and all. And have a nice day.